For many, Yom Kippur is defined by those restrictions of eating and drinking. But there are actually two 24-hour fast days in our Jewish calendar. The first, of course, is today, Yom Kippur, which tends to focus on our personal flaws. And the second is Tisha B'Av, commemorating the destruction of the two temples in Jerusalem and a litany of tragedies that have befallen our people. And on that day, we reflect on the collective sins. Our tradition draws a clear connection between the moral behavior of the Jewish people and our right to exist. Therefore, Jewish survival is conditional on our willingness and capacity to change and build a society worth perpetuating. So, what was the great sin that caused the temples to be destroyed, the ancient rabbis ask? What did we do wrong? And their most famous answer is that the ancient temple in Jerusalem, that bastion of political and religious life, was destroyed not because of some foreign power, but because of the baseless and senseless hatred, the Sinat Chinam in Hebrew, that existed between groups of Jews who lived in the city at the time. Jewish societies are most threatened by forces within. Divisiveness, claims the rabbis, is the internal enemy that can bring a society to its knees. It's even one of the sins that we actually just beat our chests about during the Vidui, the translation in our prayer book, the harm we have caused in your world by hating without cause. In our country, as we all know, we have moved into a remarkably ugly and divisive reality where expressions of sinat chinam, of baseless and senseless hatred, are infused into political rhetoric, our social media feeds, and even our personal relationships. In the fall of 2020, researchers published an article in the journal Science declaring that political hatred has become Americans' animating faith. Politics has become an evangelical religion. In the late 1950s, Gallup asked a random sample of Americans whether they wanted their daughter to marry a Democrat or a Republican, and 72% either didn't respond or said they didn't care. But then in 2016, a professor here at UCLA found that times had changed. In that year, there was more desire for same-party marriage than ever before, with only 45% of Americans not caring one way or the other. And after everything we have experienced in the last 6 years, I wouldn't be surprised if many now consider interpolitical marriage to be the greatest threat to family and cultural continuity, even supplanting the age-old concern about intermarriage. I believe that one of the greatest factors contributing to that divisiveness is the fact that it is getting more difficult and more dangerous to engage in productive disagreement and debate. We are becoming so closed off and so disappointed in one another that we're starting to believe that there is little to no value in even engaging with those who see things differently. I had one person tell me recently that they're not going to their uncle's for Thanksgiving this year, because the thought of sitting at the same table with some members of the family who voted for the other guy was just too disturbing to comprehend. Or a friend who was throwing a dinner party but was torn about whether to invite a certain couple because the wife had posted some things on social media that had been really upsetting, and the hostess didn't want to see this woman in person because she just didn't know what would happen. The number of times I have heard someone say, "He turned to the dark side," or I can't talk to her anymore. She's just going to try and convince me of X or Y. How many of you have changed plans, declined an invitation, unfriended someone online, or simply avoided a topic because of differences of opinions and beliefs? The problem is that if we never engage, we perpetuate the isolation and widen the divide. I happen to be an optimist at heart, and I fundamentally believe that the majority of people are not on the extremes, that there is a quiet and often silent majority who hold a complex and nuanced set of beliefs. It's that majority that I want us to focus on today, because today is a day during which we are supposed to reflect and recalibrate in order to prevent our personal and collective sins and shortcomings from further dividing and destroying what we are working so hard to build, a life and a society built on righteousness and peace and love. There's a joke about three Jews who are about to be executed by firing squad. The sergeant in charge asks each one if they want a blindfold. "Yes," says the first Jew in a resigned tone. "Okay," whispers the second one. He asks the third one, "Well, what about you?" And the third Jew says, "No, I don't want your lousy blindfold." At which point the second Jew turns to him and says, "Listen, Larry, take the blindfold. Don't make any trouble." Right now, there's a lot of fear about speaking up and disagreeing with others. Rabbi Lieder likes to talk about the Buddhist concept of tending to the part of the garden that we can reach, and it is so true. There's no way that we are going to end the divisiveness and anger overnight, but today is a perfect day to reflect on what each one of us can realistically do to bring about some change. Our tradition offers us some wisdom. It centers around the Jewish concept of machloket. So repeat after me, machloket. Right? Rolls right off the tongue. Machloket is translated as debate or disagreement, and it is at the center of our tradition's understanding of how we are supposed to engage in the world. The well-known adage, two Jews, three opinions, is linked to the concept of machloket. And our stereotypical association of Jews arguing and disagreeing is probably a direct result of this ancient practice found at the center of most rabbinic discussions about Torah. It's arguing done right. And right now, we all could use a refresher on how to argue with one another without trying to burn it all down. Machloket teaches us that an argument is not designed to have a clear winner and loser, something counter to the way in which we position arguments in today's world. The goal of disagreement and debate is to open the door to the possibility of change, to plant a seed. I actually love the way Adam Grant, an organizational psychologist, puts it. A good debate is not a war. It's not even a tug of war, where you can drag your opponent to your side if you pull hard enough on the rope. It's more like a dance that hasn't been choreographed, negotiated with a partner who has a different set of steps in mind. If you try too hard to lead, your partner will resist. If you can adapt your moves to theirs and get them to do the same, you're more likely to end up in rhythm. We need to stop trying to win, because when that's our mentality, we're only going to lose. As a parent, I am reminded of this on a regular basis. There have been many times when I have been arguing with one of my daughters about something, and we're going back and forth and really going at it, and I'm, of course, secretly enjoying it. And Julia will step in and say to me, "Joel, stop trying to win. it's not going to work. And she's right. It's not that I'm necessarily wrong with the point I'm trying to make, but my attempt to win just makes my daughter dig in her heels and stick to her guns even more. Machloket reminds us that the goal of an argument is to learn. It's for this reason that the full phrase by the rabbis is Machloket Lashem Shemayim, an argument for the sake of heaven, in other words, an argument for the sake of the greater good. The people who did this best, according to our tradition, were Hillel and Shammai. These two rabbis who created schools of thought that were diametrically opposed to one another, and yet they argued more than 300 times in the Talmud. It's what our tradition teaches us about Hillel and Shammai that I believe is the key to the skill set that allows us to walk into that Thanksgiving family gathering, to show up at that friend's barbecue, or to sit at the same table with that person. So what were the secrets of this productive and successful debate? The House of Hillel always did three things. First, they were kind and gracious whenever they argued. In other words, they were respectful. Second, they spent time learning their opponent's argument and taught that argument alongside their own. In other words, they actively listened to the details of the other side, so much so that they understood the details and intricacies enough to be able to teach it themselves. And lastly, whenever they were debating with the school of Shammai, they would teach Shammai's position first before their own. They expressed some kind of awareness about the importance of their opponent's opinion, as if to say, I know you feel strongly about this, and I'm going to prove to you that I am open-minded by presenting your opinion first before I even share my thoughts on the matter. This ancient Jewish wisdom seems like a masterclass in debate strategy. Respect, active listening, empathy. The three things that our tradition upholds as the keys to a successful disagreement. So I want to share something special with you. On April 6th, 1962, the famous composer Leonard Bernstein walked out on stage at Carnegie Hall to introduce the New York Philharmonic's performance of the Brahms D minor concerto. The piece called for a piano soloist, and on that evening, it was Mr. Glenn Gould, one of the most well-respected pianists of the 20th century. Bernstein and Gould fundamentally disagreed about how the piece should be performed, and Bernstein launched into an unanticipated introduction that led that evening's performance to be deemed one of the most controversial in the orchestra's history. And I think it beautifully illustrates the power of our tradition's approach to disagreement and debate, and so I want us to listen to an edited version of the introduction together.
Don't be frightened, Mr. Gould is here, will appear in a moment. I'm not, as you know, in the habit of speaking on any concert except the Thursday night previews, but a curious situation has arisen, which merits, I think, a word or two. You are about to hear a rather, shall we say, unorthodox performance of the Brahms D minor concerto. A performance distinctly different from any I've ever heard, or even dreamt of, for that matter. I cannot say I am in total agreement with Mr. Gould's conception. And this raises the interesting question, what am I doing conducting? But the age-old question still remains, in a concerto, who is the boss, the soloist, or the conductor? The answer is, of course, sometimes one, sometimes the other, depending on the people involved. But almost always, the two manage to get together by persuasion or charm or even threats to achieve a unified performance. So why, to repeat the question, am I conducting it? Why do I not make a minor scandal, get a substitute soloist, or that insisted. Because I am fascinated, glad to have the chance for a new look at this much-played work. Because, what's more, there are moments in Mr. Gould's performance that emerge with astonishing freshness and conviction. Thirdly, because we can all learn something from this extraordinary artist who is a thinking performer. And finally, because there is in music what Dimitri Mitropoulos used to call the sportive element, that factor of curiosity, adventure, experiment. And I can assure you that it has been an adventure this week, collaborating with Mr. Gould on this Brahms concerto. And it's in this spirit of adventure that we now present it to you.
And that, to me, is the way in which we all must address this divisive and frustrating time for our nation. We have an incredible opportunity right now to move away from sinat chinam, from senseless and baseless hatred, and move towards machloket l'shem shemayim, arguments for the sake of the greater good. Let's use the skills set forth by our tradition and not only engage in some of the harder conversations, but to do so in the spirit of Hillel and Shammai. We must learn to create music, sometimes cacophonous, sometimes out of tune, but always with the hope of utilizing the wisdom of machloket. We can create some kind of harmony, some kind of unified performance, and maybe we'll even start enjoying that family Thanksgiving gathering once again. Gemar Chatima Tovah.